the black slaves did not represent this evening. It was a bad night for them. The first round, he was running into a clinch. He wasn't throwing punches. Running into a clinch, his hands were down by his knees. That was a weird fight.
He seemed more interested in smiling and I guess
that. Yeah. I don't know if he thought he could out-slick him. And, I don't know what he thought. He looked terrible.
Yeah, and you said the same thing about Rashad as well.
I mean, both of them looked out of shape. Rashad did nothing but this all night. They had a bad night. I don't know. They probably got to reevaluate some things in their camp. And
it's not great because Vitor last week, 2 weeks ago, made a very good fight training.
He looked good.
Well, what do you make of Strikeforce? I mean, you touched on it briefly up there, but Strikeforce had an incredible night tonight.
You know what? It was so fun, too, because after the fight, like I said, after the fights were over, all those guys were coming back to my room. And they were so excited and pumped. How about that? You know, obviously the main event was awesome. Frankie comes back, whatever. But Bobby Green, man, Bobby Green, vocal. He, first of all, that ref. Okay. First of all, you. Apparently, she's never seen, you know, this kid fight before. And when he gets you down, that kid Green was on top and doing damage the entire time. They had like a ticker, like you were going like this, tick, 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 of all the shots. He was going body head, body head, body head, and she stands them up. And I was freaking out in the dressing room. What was so cool is that this kid, I was saying, you know, why are you engaging? Why are you doing this? And when I was saying it, Rogan was saying it, his corner was yelling stuff. This kid just stayed so aggressive and tried to win and did everything he could to win that fight and then took it out of the judges' hands, too. Because as bad a ref as she is, the last thing you need is that going into the judges' hands after that, too. That kid wanted to win that fight. He had tons of heart. I love that fight. That was my favorite fight of the night. That was my favorite fight of the night.
Is there anything
Bobby Green's getting a check.
Yeah. Does he get something special for that?
He will. That was a fun fight. I had a good time watching that fight. And I liked how he had like the will to win tonight, man. Nothing was going to stop that kid from winning tonight.
A little bit of showmanship, though. He was smiling at the camera, doing all kinds of things while he was fighting.
Awesome. I love that fight. Bobby Green. Jay Haran went to the hospital. He's okay. And now they're going to send Frankie. Frankie's going to go right now for a patient.
What do you do with Frankie, man? Obviously, he's a great fighter and a tremendous heart. I mean, how do you not be a fan of the guy? But you can't keep giving him title shots, right? I mean, what do you do with him?
Yeah, well, he'll get in line now and he'll start fighting his way back.
Do you think you'd like to see him stay at 145? Were you happy with him there?
He's not going to 145. That's not going to happen.
One of his coaches in the countdown said, heck, he should be down at 135 because of his body type.
Okay. I like that better. Good. The lower he goes, the happier I am. I don't want him going any higher. I don't like him going higher.
You mind seeing him at 135?
Huh?
You mind seeing him at 135?
Sure. Yeah. That's what I said. The lower he goes, the happier I'll get. I like Frankie Edgar a lot as a person. Take away the whole fighting thing. I like him as a person, as a human being. And I don't ever want to see him at 155 pounds. These guys are too big and too strong at 55. Yes, I know he was the champion. I know he beat legends and had close fights and everything else, but you can only fight so long those types of wars with bigger, stronger guys. It's not good. I never liked it.
Dana, what did you text at his back? Or did you?
I didn't. Yeah, I didn't. Friggin' maniac.
I mean, did that cross your mind at all? Because I saw on Twitter.
Hell yeah, it crossed. It didn't cross my mind until he texted me. But yeah, it's crossing my mind now. I like it. I like Pettis, man. Yeah.
That's fresh, but what do you do with guys like Ricardo Lamas and Korean Zombie who are both right there knocking on the door already? Can you leapfrog those
there
guys,
you go.
What do you do?
If he went down and fought you do the Zombie and Lamas. But they're Lamas, Zombie's hurt. Zombie's out for a while still.
Do you know when Zombie's going to be back?
I wanted to say May. Ooh. Yeah, he's out.
What do you think Fedez's motivation is in doing that, given that you just said last week, hey, he's next for the 55 shot? Just that he wouldn't be able to do it till fall?
People were saying that he doesn't cut weight for 55. Like, doesn't cut weight at all. And he can make 45 easily. Which is shocking to me, because he looks like a big kid when I see him, you know, in person, but it's interesting.
Aldo says he lets you make the fights and he just takes what comes. Is that true for your experience with him? Do you think he'll be receptive to it?
Yeah, listen, there's never really any times where guys are refusing to take fights around here. You'll see that the odd, we're teammates and, you know, stuff like that, but in the UFC, guys don't try to turn down fights. And usually if it starts to happen, it's guys that are on their losing streaks and, you know, they don't want to. It's very rare. It happens few and far between.
You mentioned,
look at all the fights that we make and how many fights are, you know, I'd rather not fight him, that type of stuff.
You mentioned Anderson wants a fight in April. Weidman isn't projected to come back till early summer. Can you push it on?
We don't know. We don't know when he's going to come back. We got to find a fight first. We got to make the fight. We got to make sure Weidman's all right. The later, the better for Weidman, probably.
Does he really want to come back and fight the best of all time?
Huh?
Does he really want to come back and fight the best of all time for being off?
Dude, not only does he want to come back and fight the best of all time, he said, I will smash this guy. I'll fight him in Brazil, and I'll give him the rematch in Madison Square Garden. You know, so he's pretty confident with that fight.
And Lorenzo going to go to New York anytime soon? Or Mark, anyone going to go to New York State anytime soon?
New York, we just had a big New York meeting yesterday or the day before. I can't remember.
They're promising?
All my days mold together. I can't remember what's what, but yeah, it's always promising. We always have great conversations about New York, and then these dirtbags end up pulling something else out of their hat, meaning the Las Vegas Culinary Union.
Just to clarify
who the dirtbags are.
I know you said earlier this week that you weren't involved in the Josh Barnett talks at all, but people with the heavyweight being kind of wide open now after tonight, people are saying, you know, could that guy slide in? Do you have any update on him, and could he slide into a number one contender or a title shot?
I should have asked Joe that tonight. Oh, Joe's been dealing with it. I haven't met him, so. But I can tell you this, I haven't heard anything negative. I haven't got any calls going, Josh Barnett's crazy, he's out of his mind. I haven't had any of those calls, so.
Could he walk into a title fight?
No. There's no way. Cormier's here, you know what I mean? Yeah.
To follow on that, with Overeem out now and situation kind of mixed up, would you kind of push for Cormier if he beats Frank Mir to stay at heavyweight and fight Kane?
There's so many options. I would be shocked if Cormier came out and said and fought Mir and beat Mir. Said, now I want Cain Velasquez. I'd be shocked.
I would too.
I would see him coming out and saying, I want to go to 205 before that. But he's never said that to me, just so you know. From what I understand, Cain and Cormier would fight each other, from what I understand. But I would be shocked if he did. I mean, those guys were in there hugging for 15 minutes after he won the title, you know what I mean? But who knows, man? They're pretty serious guys, and like I always say, it's all about proving who the best is, and you know, that guy might be my friend, but he's got what I want, and I know what I get when I get that belt. Because all the guys who have a champ in their camp, they see how these guys live and what, you know, what the deal is when you have that belt. When you have that belt, it's a whole nother ballgame.
Well, and they're both wrestlers. They're not unused to fighting.
You know, both of them come from a wrestling background where, you know, teammates, you know, it does happen.
He literally verbatim just said what you said. Exactly. It's true. True.
With this pay-per-view over, Ronda's next. Can you give us some hints as to what kind of mini tour she's going to be doing?
Yeah, I'll tell you guys that. You know, I told you the other day. Nah, I don't want to talk about it.
Little something?
Yeah. There's been so much negative bullshit about this fight. I want to do what we're planning on doing. And I just want to, you know, I like to stick it. I'm going to do it, and we'll stick it when the fight's over. You know?
Dana, are you pretty confident that this is something that Rashad can come back from, or do you think he kind of fits into that mold of a guy who's made a lot of money, he's fought for the title a couple times?
Huh?
Is this something you think that Rashad can come back from, you got confidence in him to come back, or do you think he kind of fits into that mold of a guy who's made a lot of money and maybe his hunger is gone?
Yeah, I to be honest with you, Rashad and I have a good relationship. I like Rashad a lot. He's a good guy, smart guy, you know. He has lost that hunger. He's lost that desire and that drive, and he needs to get it back. There's no doubt about it. He needs to get hungry again, man. He was always, me and Rashad had our moments here and there when he was young and coming off tough and everything else. You know, the brand stuff and all that stuff that went down with me and him. But Rashad has always been, you know, he's a smart guy. You know, he's a guy that you sit down, you can talk to. Sometimes he gets a little, not anymore. I shouldn't say that. That's unfair. Back in the day, like you think the world's out to get you. He's
paranoid.
He was always a little paranoid, yeah. He's always a little paranoid. But he would always do the right thing. He needs to get that fire back. He doesn't have that fire, man. He has to get it. Rashad used to train like a beast. Rashad never used to get tired. Rashad could go. The only time you saw Rashad get tired is when he first came into the UFC and he fought Tito in that first fight, you know? Then after that, he turned into an absolute beast. He's got to get it back.
He told me this.
Because I'll tell you what, these fucking Brazilian guys are hungry.
He told me this week from this time that he was off.
There you go.
But he said that he
if
did.
If that word back. Even comes out of your mouth in this business, it's a negative. Bad.
He said during that time he realized he was a fighter and fighting is what he does, and it seemed like he thought he had to fight even back. Said
the R word.
Yeah.
It shows you right there where his head is at and what he's thinking. You know? Make a few million bucks. You know what I mean? Make a few million bucks. You guys have watched the shows. You see his fucking house? See the cars he drives? You see all that stuff?
Yeah. Do you have an idea about the next Brazilian event? Maybe?
Or another Brazilian event?
Yeah.
I don't know, my friend.
Yeah.
I don't know. We got a lot of work to do in Brazil. Lorenzo's going to be living down in Brazil.
Bigfoot said something interesting about the Black Stallions calling it a business. They didn't have a good night tonight. They seem to have been in a bit of a rough stretch as of late. What do you think about that? Do you think there's some validity to
that? Don't ever fool yourself. They're all a business. Every one of them. That's what I said about Greg Jackson. We're a family. We're this, we're that. We're a business. Say it any two ways you want it. The reason people like the American Top Team, when all these guys that go to the American Top Team, the guy who owns, funds, and runs the American Top Team is one of the most generous human beings I've ever met in my life. And, you know, he really takes care of those guys down there. And I've always heard nothing but good things. And every dealing I've ever had with that guy has been good and positive. And for all the right reasons.
Dan Lambert?
Talk about Dan Lambert, yeah.
Dan Lambert. Dan Lambert is one of the, you know, you want to talk about one of the truly, truly good human beings in this sport. And what this guy has done for fighters when there was no money in the sport to now when there's tons of money in the sport. You know, that's why the guys who train down American Top Team feel that way, is because of Dan Lambert.
You know, after UFC, I remember UFC 124 when he won the K-1 Grand Prix, and everyone was very excited about him maybe coming to the UFC, and he was like, this guy's a kickboxer. You were not sold. The Brock fight, you got a bit on the bandwagon. After tonight, you say, you know, maybe I was right, he is not a top-level heavyweight?
I say he looked terrible tonight, that's what I say. You know, I think Rashad's a great fighter. Rashad looked terrible tonight. You know.
Do you think that reflects on the team? Because, I mean, the team in Melvin didn't look so great the last fight either.
Yeah, I agree. They got some work to do down there at Black Williams, you know? They got some work to do. They did not look good. Vitor did.
Yeah, that's right.
But they didn't look good. It's, you know.
You keep referring to the card up in Montreal as a welterweight tournament. Do you guys actually kind of have that bracketed out?
No, that's just too
bad. Not a true bracket, but I mean, kind of have guys penciled in.
I mean, it really is a welterweight tournament. It's all the best guys, you know. Six best welterweights in the world.
So it's more just a filtering out card where you can kind of see where
Yeah, we're going to see where Maya sits. We're going to, you know, a lot of things will flush out once that fight happens.
So, are you more intrigued by the Aldo Pettis match or the possibility of Pettis and Henderson rematching from the best fights in the last few years?
Say that again?
Aldo versus Pettis or the potential for Pettis to fight Ben Henderson again?
Yeah. Right? Those are both great fights. No, I agree. Both great fights.
How are you going to make them up?
Yeah, so maybe what you do is he texted me, so I told you. You know, maybe you do the Ben Henderson fight. You know what I mean? he doesn't win, he goes down and fights Aldo 45. I don't know. Maybe he goes to 45 and does that, and then drops the belt, moves to 55. I don't know.
What about Melendez? That's a lock. That probably is for sure, right? Gilbert Melendez. And,
yeah. Yeah, that's done.
Hey, your buddy.
Something important happened in today's fight. The three main events were won by Brazilians. I was wondering if there's something that the UFC is doing in terms of scouting to bring Mexican fighters so that hopefully, like, maybe in a year, the three main events will be won.
We did. We just did a big scouting trip down into Mexico, and it went very well.
So is Mexico the next Brazil?
Well, let's not get crazy here. Brazil is off the charts. Brazil is like, Brazil's a whole I want the United States to be the next Brazil. I want that to happen. Yeah, I see Mexico working out. I always did since day one. But Brazil is, when I used to talk about how big Canada was, the U.S. took off or whatever, Brazil is smoking everything right now. Brazil is craziness.